From the time of his official retirement to his death just under 40 years later, Liszt devoted himself to composing, conducting, and teaching. He did, in fact, play in public now and again, but never for money, nor did he ever accept a penny from his many students who flocked to him from all over the Western world. In some ways, he was simply being true to an artistic creed first enunciated, a little pompously, when he was 28.
May the artist of the future gladly and readily decline to play the conceited and egotistical role which we hope has had in Paganini its last brilliant representative. May he set his goal from within and not outside himself, and be the means of virtuosity, not its end. May he constantly keep in mind that though the saying is noblesse oblige, in a far higher degree than nobility, génie oblige.
Genius, in other words, has obligations. Well, now, having, as he felt, discharged his obligations to the public, Liszt prepared to meet his responsibilities to the art of music itself and at the highest level of aspiration. He accepted a long-offered invitation to become Kapellmeister at the court of Weimar in Germany, where an already established orchestra and opera house were ready and waiting. He now stood on the threshold of the second great phase of his life as a musician. The time was right, he knew it, and it felt good.
Here I breathe. I feel something in the very air that proclaims Weimar a cultivated, an artistic town. It looks just as I imagined. Calm, luminous, contemplative, full of air and light, and set in a landscape of streams, wooded hills, and charming valleys. How my heart beats as I walk through it.
And it beat still faster with the imminent arrival of the princess, who was to play a key part in Liszt's Weimar years and beyond. Naturally, there was some curiosity to see this latest of Liszt's amorous conquests, but the reality caused an equal sense of puzzlement and disappointment. Among the most articulate eyewitnesses to this was the travelling English novelist Marianne Evans, better known as George Eliot.
The appearance of the princess rather startled me. I had expected to see a tall, distinguished woman, if not a beautiful one. But she is short and unbecomingly plump. At first glance, the face is not pleasing, and the profile especially is harsh and barbarian. Her teeth, unhappily, are blackish, too.
The result, in part, of too many cigars. With the princess's unwavering support, Liszt set about transforming an already cultured city into the musical capital of Europe. Above all, it was to be a bastion of the avant-garde, the crucible in which the much-touted music of the future was to be forged. The fervour, the unbridled passion of Liszt's crusade was very much a child of its time. His arrival as the musical general of Weimar coincided with a wave of political unrest throughout Europe. Well, unrest is putting it mildly. The continent was fairly ablaze with armed revolution. Heavy fighting broke out in Paris, Vienna, Berlin, Milan, Venice, Rome, Parma, and Prague, among other places. There were vicious crackdowns in Poland. Hungary rumbled ominously on the brink of catastrophic upheavals. Thousands were dying, many more being imprisoned or worse. Like many other liberally minded people, Liszt observed the smouldering scene with an uneasy mixture of horror and excitement. From his position on the sidelines, it was easy to pretend that he actually envied those who were in the thick of the fray. His former secretary, for one.
Belloni is more fortunate than I. As a lieutenant of the National Guard, he dated his last letter from the Paris Town Hall. But I am forgetting that I hate politics. And indeed, during the last 15 years, this is the first enthusiasm which has gripped me.
Unlike the more politicized Wagner, who took part in the uprising in Dresden, Liszt himself made little or no attempt to participate in any of these great events, though he did lend his moral support in the way of a workers' chorus which his publisher thought too inflammatory to release. And on a visit to Vienna, where revolutionaries had successfully ousted the hated Prince Metternich, he provided his young pupil, Janosch Dunkel, with an imperishable boyhood memory.
In the stormy days of the year 1848, I visited the barricades with Liszt, which were commanded by the well-known bass singer Karl Formisch. Liszt presented the workers posted there with cigars and gold. Instead of all his medals, he wore a cockade of the Hungarian national colours in the buttonhole of his jacket.
Hungary at that time being a subject nation in the Austrian Habsburg Empire. Inspired by the apparent success of the French and Viennese uprisings, Hungarian revolutionaries too took to the streets, and Hungary's greatest poet, Sándor Petőfi, outlined their demands in an emotional speech on the steps of the National Museum in Pest. When news of these events reached Liszt, he was much stirred, of course, but he expressed his support in curiously muted terms.
"My compatriots have just taken a step that is so decisive, so Hungarian, and so unanimous, that it is impossible to withhold a tribute of legitimate sympathy."
Many people at the time felt that Liszt should have been doing rather more than issuing tributes of sympathy and handing out cigars. His friends and many distinguished artists, the poet Petőfi among them, were suffering death, execution, and torture. Liszt's defence of his apparent passivity was brief and to the point.
"I would be the first to answer the call to arms, to give my blood and not tremble before the guillotine. If it were the guillotine that could give this world peace and mankind happiness. But who believes that? We are concerned with bringing peace to the world, in which the individual is justly treated by society."
Well, the dividing line between idealism and fantasy is sometimes very hard to find. Liszt was perhaps a little naive, he may have lacked a certain kind of courage, but there can hardly be any doubt that he contributed far more to civilization as a living composer than he would have as a dead martyr. As an artist, he was as daring and revolutionary as any composer before or since. And the plain fact is that most of the military and political revolutions which shook the world in his lifetime turned out to be abject failures in the long run. Liszt's revolutions, on the other hand, and those he sponsored, fundamentally affected the course of Western music. Within a remarkably short time of his arrival in Weimar, he transformed it into the Mecca of modern music. Among those who were drawn to the city as by a magnet were such disparate musicians as Brahms, Berlioz, Verdi, Borodin, Smetana, Grieg, and Schumann. Another was the young, brilliant, fire-breathing Hans von Bülow, who declared to the world with characteristic venom and passion,
"We Weimarists are going to win, you'll see. We shall rule, and our opponents will dissolve in gall and be poured away down the closet of the past. And our art, the true, the noble, the high, will thrive greatly. And Liszt will be hailed as the founder of interpretive art with all its implications, and the initiator of a new era."
Thank you.
part of the so-called symphonic poem Prometheus. Liszt was the inventor both of the concept and the name of the symphonic poem. Basically, it's a one-movement work whose shape and tone are based fairly literally on a particular non-musical idea, poetic, descriptive, historical, or whatever. It's deliberately illustrative music, music that tells a story. Program music, as it's called, as opposed to absolute music, which makes no external references. Liszt's example was seized on by many other composers, most notably Smetana, Tchaikovsky, Richard Strauss, and Sibelius.